When making a game that contains characters of any kind, animation is fundamental to bring the game to life, as the characters are often the focal point of the player. In an action game, even more so, as they usually boast a wide range of abilities which not only require different animation clips, but also to blend them together in a convincing way. Making transitions invisible, adding randomization, having characters use tools that interact with the environment, and perform two actions at the same time are all interesting touches to add, which can be obtained with clever use of all the animation tools that Unity offers. In this fifth devlog for Chop Chop, we'll take a look at a few techniques we've used to put together the animation controllers for the characters in the game. Chop Chop is the open-source adventure game demo we're making together with the community as part of the Open Projects initiative. As always, the whole game project is available to download, explore, and contribute to using the link provided in the description below. Let's start with the protagonist, an adventurous pig chef named Hamlet. Hamlet can walk, run, jump, talk to other characters, collect items, and take part in fights, which require swinging his walking stick, getting hit, and fainting. In addition to that, he has a couple of tools that presented some interesting cases for animation, like his walking cane, or the lantern that he carries around on his back, which houses his trusty companion, a small phoenix chick. Let's start by taking a look at its animation controller. The entry point is obviously the idle state. Before moving on to anything else, notice how many of our core transitions have the property has exit time set to false. This is because to make the controls feel responsive, all transitions between idle, walking, jumping, and attack need to happen as soon as the player presses the right control. Having this property set to false ensures that the transition begins straight away, instead of waiting for the clip to finish. For this same reason, our transition durations are also usually very low, a quarter of a second or something similar. This is especially true for the jump action, which propels Hamlet upwards instantly without any anticipation, as it's common in arcade platforms or action games. To hide this lack of preparation, we use a dust particle system that engulfs the character's legs. On the contrary, transitions back to idle from collect or cane hit do have an exit time, since they are fixed time actions, so we want to wait for the clip to end before moving away from it. From idle, he transitions to the walk state when a Boolean parameter is walking is set to true. However, the walk state is not a regular state, but a blend tree. This special state allows us to blend two different clips based on one parameter, which for us is a float called moving speed. Notice how our walk cycle and run cycle don't have the same duration, but are still blended correctly. The first clip lasts half as long as the second one. Actually, there was a small mistake in the creation of these clips. In the walk cycle, Hamlet starts with the left foot forward, while in the run cycle, the foot ahead is the right one. No big deal. We use the cycle offset property on the clip to ensure that the whole clip is shifted forward by half, so that both clips would start with the same foot, ensuring a perfect blend. One small note. Blend trees have an inherent cost, so don't abuse them. In fact, to obtain the final pose, Unity has to evaluate all clips included in them, so they are inherently more expensive than a normal state, which plays one clip. However, they are a fundamental tool for complex locomotion controllers, so use them when appropriate. To make the idle more unpredictable, we created multiple idle clips and we play them randomly when the previous one is over, or when coming back from the walk state. There are several ways to achieve this. What we went with is to attach a state machine behavior to the idle state, which, on state enter, sets an integer to a random value. This means that the next time the state machine has to transition to an idle state, a different idle will be played. The code is incredibly simple, and we just need to make sure that this script is added on the right states. We do a similar thing for other characters that have variations, like for the barred hares singing. In addition to this, when working with variations on the same state, we bundle them all into a sub-state machine, which is just a visual tool of the animator controller to group a bunch of states into one. Since they have exactly the same function in the game, it makes sense to treat these variation states as one and hide the complexity in the sub-state machine. In fact, we can now modify the state machine behavior script mentioned before, and instead of having the code in onStateEnter, we can put it in onStateMachineEnter. This way, we just need to add the script to the sub-state machine rather than to each potential idle state. In fact, we ended up using sub-state machines for more than random clips. For instance, we use it to isolate our simple combo system, used when the player presses the attack button repeatedly. To address the usage of tools, we decided to use the extra functionality provided by the animation rigging package. We asked our animator to create idle, walking, and running clips with the character not holding its walking cane. This gives us clean animation clips where both hands are free, which we can use in cutscenes to create some variety. For gameplay, though, we rigged the character with extra controls to allow him to wield the walking cane while performing these actions. Specifically, we added an IK constraint on his right hand so that the hand is locked onto the walking cane when needed. Then, we duplicated the clips we need from the .fbx files, creating independent clips that'll represent our walking cane variations, to which we add just a few keyframes related to the IK itself. For the idle, it was as simple as just posing the hand and keyframing it so it didn't look too stiff. We also turned off the IK midway through the clip so that he lifts the cane up and has the freedom to perform his look-around motion. In this clip, we also make use of another constraint, multi-aim. We use it in an unconventional way, which is to ensure that the wrist is looking towards a point on the ground. By doing so, when we move the wrist IK control, the wrist rotates as if looking towards a fixed spot on the tip of the cane, giving the illusion that the cane is firmly planted on the ground. For the walking animation, we simply turn on the IK on the hand and animate it up and down, while simultaneously animating the point on the ground forward and back in sync with the walk cycle. This creates the illusion that Hamlet is using the walking cane to support himself. For the running clip, we turn off the aim constraint and we just use the wrist IK to 60% strength. This makes it so that the hand is still moving back and forth as you would expect when running, but not as frantically because it's also holding the cane. The mix of both motions creates the effect of the weight of the walking cane in a very natural way. If you want more information on animation rigging and how to set it up, check out a video on the topic made last year. The link is in the description. Finally, another small trick we used, which is not very well known, is animator override controllers. We have two variations on the base townsfolk, male and female, and our animation states in the way they are triggered is identical, but not the motion they perform. So we've created one animator controller for the male model, where we set up its states and transitions. And then, we have an animation override controller for the female model, which swaps in the male clips with the ones made specifically for her. We plan to use this also with other characters. For instance, the ones who are holding an object, so we can swap in object-wielding animations very much like the ones we made for the Pig Chef. This means we only need to manage one animator controller and the changes will be reflected to all townsfolk, eliminating tedious work and potential mistakes. As you know, this project is a continuous evolution. For instance, right now, the character stops when attacking since we don't have an animation that includes walking and attacking at the same time. To enable that, we are looking into using layers to have the ability to mix multiple motions into one. Layers are a great tool to control different parts of the body of a character independently. In our case, this means having a layer dedicated to the cane swing states and using it only for the upper body. To do this, we set the layer to override, its weight to 1, and we assign an avatar mask to tell Unity which bones to affect. When the player presses the attack button, we transition from a state with no motion to the one containing the attack clip. The fact that the first state has no motion attached to it means that the pose of the upper body, as imposed by the default layer, will be untouched. This gives us the ability to transition to add the motion contained in the cane hit state to any underlying base state, so we can play the attack while walking, while jumping, and so on. We could, potentially, use the same trick to create a layer where the character is just holding out his lantern while performing other actions. This layering multiplies the perceived range of capabilities of the character, while at the same time reducing the number of clips we need to produce and maintain. As we work with multiple layers and states that don't necessarily animate the full character, one setting to watch out for is right defaults, which is a setting present on all animation states. If right defaults is set to on, when the state machine transitions to that state, the default values for all bones will be used, even if that specific state doesn't animate them. So for instance, a clip that only animates the left arm and the shoulder will also reset all of the other bones' default positions. If it's set to off, all bones not involved in a state won't be updated, meaning that they will stay in the position set by previous states. In the previous example, the clip would animate the left arm, but not make any change to any other part of the body. As you can imagine, when layering multiple animation clips, ignoring this setting may produce very unexpected results. Finally, another simple but effective way to add life to characters is to have NPCs look at the player when he gets close enough, something which you want to add using the multi-aim constraint in the animation rigging package, and a simple trigger zone so that the constraint is gradually turned on, creating an illusion that the NPC is turning its head. If you found this devlog interesting and want to jump in and contribute to the development of ChopChop, check out the project on GitHub and come discuss its progress on the Unity forums. The wiki on GitHub will get you up to speed if you plan to contribute. All the links are in the description of this video. Thanks for watching.